oh, that's not quite what I meant, and, you know.
Yeah, but they're going to be open to editing, whereas,
yes.
like, I don't know.
Many people don't edit.
Yeah. Like, I feel like there are a lot of, like, music, who cares? Like, a lot of, I feel like a lot of people in, like, music fandoms or whatever.
I know there's some pretty serious geeks in the music world. You know, you get to the jazz people, and suddenly it's crazy nuts. Yeah.
That's a good point. But I don't know, like, I feel like math and physics are very exact.
Yes.
And so, like,
there is a right answer. At least there was until quantum mechanics came along.
The right answer? No.
I was taught that there was a right answer when
yeah.
I was doing physics. You know, but that
well, there's
was,
a right answer in a certain frame.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
In a Newtonian frame, there definitely is a right answer.
Absolutely.
In
yes.
a, like, everything up until the past 120 years.
That shows how old I am, because...
Yes, you were. Before Einstein. Pre-Einstein, you know. No, probably not. Who knows?
So, with the, with your studies on quantum computing, did you have artificial intelligence as well?
No, I love that to the other people. There are a lot of people who are doing that. Oh, man, AI.
It's interesting
stuff. I'm not surprised by it. I'm not... It's one of the subjects that I think is really interesting, and it brings in a big lot of questions about what intelligence actually is.
Yeah.
And I would be more interested in exploring the philosophy behind what makes us feel like we're that different in terms of our intelligence. Like emotions. I guess, like, from computers or from other animals. Like, you know, in terms of, like...
We're definitely closer to other animals than we are to computers.
True. But there are, like, in terms of, like... Yeah, like, definitely in terms of, like, emotions. How emotions work. No clue.
Yeah. How ideas and preferences, you know...
Get formulated.
Formed,
yeah.
You know, that sort of stuff. You know, or for that matter, even to try and find the taste of chocolate as a scientific formula. Like, what
yeah.
is the taste of chocolate? Something as simple as that. Like,
yeah.
it, you know, there's no digital equivalent of the taste of chocolate.
Not really.
No, but every human has that taste.
You taste of chocolate.
Yes, yes, exactly.
So let's not make assumptions.
Exactly. Not everyone has tasted chocolate, for better or worse, and yes.
Man, my calculus teacher grew up in Lebanon. I think I've told you this before.
I'm not sure.
He grew up in Lebanon in the war.
Yeah.
Really poor family.
Yeah.
And he lived in this small village and stuff. And he's told us a lot of stories about growing up in Lebanon and
yeah.
stuff. And his community.
This isn't all an effort to go off and make, you know, calculus more exciting. Now let me distract my... I hate calculus, so let me tell you about my home village.
He's actually...
We had the tastiest falafels ever.
No, they didn't, they got a box that was like 1 foot squared. Cubed
yeah.
every month of food supplies that fed their family of six.
Wow.
Yeah, for the month.
Wow.
Some oil, some
rice,
flour,
rice.
Some rice, some like chickpeas and stuff.
Yeah.
That yeah.
You'd
spending some sugar. Yeah, some like coffee, I think, and stuff like. But
yeah.
Not much. Not that much stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, he told us about there was this one time. That one of the kids in his class got a chocolate bar.
Right.
He was telling them about the chocolate bar. And so there was a corner, there was a store.
Yeah.
And they had chocolate bars. But his family didn't have enough money to buy one.
Right.
So he went in and he tried to steal it. And the guy, he went out of the store and the guy followed him. He was like, hey, so, where? He was like, what do you have in your pocket there? Mr. Reese was like, but what he got him to do was to give up back the chocolate bar, obviously,
yeah.
and then get him to work for a week in the store, you know, sweeping and stuff, so that he,
could
without paying him, with so that he could earn the money to
yeah.
buy the chocolate bar. But, like, he didn't actually pay him. He just was like, this is enough time that if I were paying you, would earn you a chocolate bar.
Yeah. 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 I think you did tell me that story before, but yeah, it's a really powerful one. Like, and to think all these things we all take for granted. And,
yeah.
And we shouldn't. Yeah. I don't know if your teacher has kids, but again, you're trying to go off and the kinds of worlds that he grew up in versus the
yeah.
world that they grew, are going to grow up in.
Yeah. it's interesting hearing stories from Mr. Harees. I think he's really changed my perspective on a lot of things.
Right.
Because he's never been in the, like, he's never been a, I want you guys to feel bad for me kind of way.
Right.
Right? Because, like, you know, you definitely could take it that way. You could definitely be like, I had such a hard life. I grew up in Lebanon during the war. Like, pity me.
Yeah.
But it's nothing like that.
It's good.
Yeah.
It's good.
It's a good person.
There's so many interesting ways that I was listening to it was a TED Talk that popped up in my podcast list, and this woman who grew up in the, you know, really poor part of South Africa, and, you know, talked about how she sort of, you know, not only did she come from this poor part of South Africa, but then she transitioned from, I'm not sure if it was male to female or female to male,
mm-hmm.
and had to go and deal with that transition, and she moved to a highly urban environment and just, like, tried to go off and find her roots and find the connections to what she did, and you know, but yeah, she would spend most of her time outside and with grubby knees and climbing from trees and doing stuff that was just, you know, out there. Something that you know, I spent tons and tons of time outside, waddling along in swamps and stuff, and, you know, looking for tadpoles and other things as a kid. And, you know, can't really do that. Most kids today can't really do that.
I'm not really.
No.
But I mean, like, depends on what you say about most kids. If you looked at a population thing, then people in cities, kids growing up in cities versus people growing up in communities, so, like, definitely cities is going to vastly outnumber, right? Because you've got places like Beijing and, you know.
And it's everyone's moving from
Mumbai,
the rural areas into the cities, and the cities getting bigger and bigger everywhere. Yeah. But, you know, you can still design cities to be friendly for kids. There's all kinds of ways to make that happen, whether it's just having neighborhood community schools. There's I was talking to some really neat people about Barcelona recently, which has, they're trying to sort of set it up so you've got community blocks so that you can get everything within walking distance, and that it's very there's a grid to the city, but they've tried to set it up intentionally so that it's small. You know who your neighbors are. You don't have to go off and get into a car and drive to a supermarket in order to go off and see people. You're able to have more community, more of a small-scale community focus.
I've seen a lot of really cool things about Chinese developments for cities.
Yeah.
So in terms of, like, their ideas on how to put in plants, like, you know, where they go, like, the buildings, the trees growing in the building and on the building and stuff.
Both for cooling and just for mental health.
And also carbon dioxide, and, you know, we're looking at, like, the amount of smog in China. But I also saw, like, actual footage of, it must be a very rich section in China, because obviously these houses cost a ton of money, but basically what they did is they built a neighborhood-wide pool. So instead of having roads, they just have a giant pool.
And you swim to work?